This video will demonstrate the temporal craniotomy and subtemporal approach for resection of a previously ruptured basal temporal arteriovenous malformation. Patient was in his late 20s. He presented with a sudden severe headache and new word-finding difficulty. On exam, he had a profound expressive aphasia. These are his CT images from the time of this initial presentation. They show acute interparenchymal hemorrhage involving the left basal temporal lobe with no obvious tangle of arteries or veins. His initial angiogram was negative for any evidence of arteriovenous malformation. These angiographic images are from 6 months later. These images finally demonstrate a small tangle on the basal temporal surface with an early arterialized draining vein running along this basal temporal surface. This vein is shown with the red arrows. This was a Spencer-Martin grade 1 AVM and a Lawton-Young grade 2 AVM for a supplemented grade of 3. A subtemporal approach was selected. The supine position is shown here, as is the U-shaped skin incision over the ear and the subtemporal craniotomy flap. Surgical strategy consisted of the following: a temporal craniotomy that was flush with the middle fossa floor, a subtemporal approach, identification and protection of the vein of labae and the AVM draining vein, opening of the collateral sulcus, resection of some of the adjacent fusiform gyrus, identification of the AVM with cauterization of the feeding arteries, circumferential dissection of this small nidus, ligation of the darkened vein, and complete AVM resection. Here is an overview of the surgical approach. The subtemporal surface is shown at the top of the screen. The patient's face is to the right. The back of the head is to the left. The gel foam pledget overlies the vein of labae. The initial dissection is in the subtemporal space, and these large vessels coming out of the tentorial incisure are followed on this basal temporal surface. This is a large posterocerebral branch artery, and adjacent to this is an arterialized draining vein shown here. This arterialized draining vein is the key clue that will lead us to this AVM that is otherwise hidden from view. Here the fusiform gyrus is entered. A little bit of tissue is resected in order to reveal the collateral sulcus. As this sulcus is entered, I'm looking here for this en passage artery. This artery is too large to be feeding the AVM, as it was barely visible on the angiogram. It's really only these small branches that feed the AVM. Here, some additional tissue is resected in order to get a more superior look into this space. As the fusiform gyrus opens up, we begin to approach the site of the prior hemorrhage. These small branches off of the artery are cauterized and divided. This is a branch artery that is feeding the AVM, which is cauterized and divided. You can see that the main trunk of the parent vessel is preserved. As we get to the top of the nidus, you can see we enter the prior hemorrhage cavity from his previous bleed. This confirms that we are at the top of the nidus. We continue our circumdissection over the top of the nidus, moving the AVM inferiorly towards the tentorium. As we do so, we encounter additional small feeding arteries. These are cauterized and divided. And as we look at the vein now, we see that it has turned blue. Draining vein can now be divided since it has darkened in color. It is cauterized here and cut. This is the last attachment of the AVM, and the nidus is removed here as shown. It's quite small, which makes it difficult sometimes to hunt down. Here you see IC green video angiography confirming the absence of AV shunting in that vein. Here is a tour of the anatomy of the ambient cistern. You can see the trochlear nerve coming from the back, running in the cisternal segment here, and then entering the leaflets of the tentorium. You can also see the posterior cerebral artery by my sucker and the branches of the superior cerebellar artery running underneath the fourth nerve. Also, some of these circumflex perforating arteries, as well as the medial posterior choroidal artery, are seen. Now we gain here a view along the third nerve in front of the midbrain. Here the third nerve is lifted so as to visualize the P1 segment going over the third nerve and the basilar trunk proximal to it. You can see the basilar bifurcation in the distance. Here is our final overview showing the subtemporal exposure and nice preservation of the vein of Leber. This case is a nice example of a basal temporal AVM. These basal temporal AVMs are depicted in these illustrations. They present to the basal surface of the temporal lobe. They're typically fed by posterior temporal arteries that come from the ambient cistern. They might also be fed by middle temporal arteries coming from the lateral cortical surface. The dissection steps are shown in the illustrations to the right. The subtemporal approach gets us to the neighborhood. We then find our draining veins and feeding arteries, and then circumdissection delivers the nidus from that basal surface into that subtemporal corridor. The patient tolerated the procedure well. He had no new postoperative neurologic deficits and was discharged on post-op day 3. Here, his postoperative angiogram shows complete resection of the AVM with elimination of the arteriovenous shunting into the vein that was seen preoperatively. In conclusion, low-grade AVMs are excellent candidates for microsurgical resection, with cure achieved in almost all patients. An initially negative angiogram with a small or difficult-to-visualize AVM requires delayed repeat digital subtraction angiography. An arterialized vein is the most important clue that leads the dissection towards a small AVM that is not visualized on the cortical surface. Subarachnoid dissection with CSF release from the ambient cistern eliminates or minimizes the need for fixed retraction of the left temporal lobe. Thank you.